One night in 1875, a young Jewish man had a vision.
Suddenly, as if lightning struck, an incandescent light radiated before my eyes, and I was transported to the passage of the Jordan, where the children of Israel crossed into the Promised Land. And a great voice rang in my ears, the return of the people to the language and the land.
And it says, and ever since that time, that voice rings in my ears. That, to my mind, means that God commissioned him to call on his fellow Jews to return to the Promised Land.
Eliezer Ben-Yehuda was born in Belarus in 1858. His fascination with the Hebrew language started early, and he began studying the Bible at the age of 3. His parents wanted him to become a rabbi, so they sent him to yeshiva.
He was definitely a God-fearing man, that he was a believing man, but he was not a synagogue Jew.
After high school, Ben-Yehuda broke the news to his mother. He wanted to be a doctor, not a rabbi. So he went to the Sorbonne in Paris, where he studied medicine, Jewish history, and philosophy. He also discovered a movement that would later be known as Zionism.
There was no Zionism at the time. Herzl was still 20 years away from writing his famous Jewish state, but Eliezer was there. And Eliezer was advocating for a Jewish state. Let's go back there. Let's reestablish ourselves in that land. Let us revive the Hebrew, which is the language in which God spoke to us. Then we will resume our proper place in the scheme of things.
Ben Yehuda's plans to be a doctor ended when he developed tuberculosis.
Ben Yehuda went to a clinic, and there the doctors examined him and told him that he's doomed. He will not live to celebrate his next birthday. They said, you better make your peace with the world because you are not going to live long.
As he faced the idea of death, he remembered his vision several years earlier of God calling him to the Promised Land.
That is when he decided, when he, you know, apparently saw the writing on the wall, and he said, you know, God doesn't want me to be in Paris. God wants me to be what he showed me.
Before he left, he broke the news to his fiancée, Devorah, who was still back in Russia. But instead of writing to her directly, he wrote to her father.
He said, dear sir, I'm writing you this letter because I want you to break the news to your daughter that I have a mortal disease and I will not be able to marry her.
Devorah refused to be jilted and followed him to Jerusalem.
And so they got married. They came to Israel together. And Eliezer Ben-Yehuda claimed that he was born again in Jerusalem.
In 1881, Palestine didn't look like their idea of the Promised Land.
Jerusalem and all of the land of Israel was deserted. It was deserted by people, it was deserted by nature. And when Eliezer came back, he said, we have to bring God back to the land.
The land was deserted and the people were divided.
Until he started talking Hebrew in Jerusalem, the Jews that came from Poland only dealt with other people who came from Poland because they spoke the same language. And the people who came from Romania only spoke with other people who came from Romania.
To help unify the people, Ben-Yehuda started publishing a newspaper entirely in Hebrew. At the time, there wasn't even a Hebrew word for newspaper, or for the dictionary he would compile later. So Ben-Yehuda coined the new words himself, using roots of ancient languages like Hebrew, Canaanite, and Arabic. The ancient Hebrew word et for time, became Eton for newspaper, since a newspaper is a time-sensitive publication. A dictionary is a collection of words, and a word in Hebrew is milah, so dictionary became milon.
He would write articles for the paper, and he would say, there was a huge fire in Jerusalem. Only people didn't know the word for fire. In the back of his newspaper, he put a little list of words. And he told people, I will only have it listed once. So if you don't remember it, please cut this list and keep it.
Soon his readers started sending requests for a full dictionary. So Ben-Yehuda started compiling one. In many cases, he turned to the Bible for inspiration in creating new words. One example is the word for pistol.
He tried to find roots in old words. There's a word in Ezekiel that speaks about certain stones, and the text calls them avnei ekdach, and it doesn't tell us what ekdach is. Now, we also know about a young lad who could do wonders by using his sling with a couple of good stones. And so Eliezer put his mind to it, and he says, those stones put a hole in the head of Goliath. Maybe that was Avnei Ekdach. Today, you can use this pistol, and you can put a nice hole in somebody's head, which will kind of slow him down, you know, just like he did with Goliath. And so he decided to call that thing Ekdach, and that's the name to this day. Now, did they have pistols back in Bible days? No, they didn't. But the word fits.
Ben-Yehuda also created a committee to help him with specialized words.
What he did was he invited people who could tell him what words are necessary. For example, he had a doctor. And the doctor said to him, we need a word for syringe. We need a word for putting a band around a wound.
For his family and friends, Ben-Yehuda had a strict rule, Hebrew only. This posed a challenge for his wife, who knew Russian, French, and German, but very little Hebrew.
He said to his wife, he says, if nobody wants to talk Hebrew with you, then you're going to be without friends. I'm really sorry.
That rule also applied to his son, whom he named Ben-Zion, or son of Zion. Even as a baby, he was kept at home so he wouldn't be exposed to other languages.
He was almost 3 years old, didn't say a word. And everybody in town was whispering behind their backs that the reason was that they were only talking Hebrew to him. They said, you see, he's going to grow up to be an idiot. The mother was much more affected, apparently, by the rumors than the husband. So one day when she was alone at home, you know, she was sitting holding the baby. He was crying. And she was trying to console him and get him to quiet down. And finally, she started singing him a lullaby that her mother sang to her when she was a baby. And it was a Russian lullaby.
At that moment, Ben-Yehuda walked in.
And of course, he raised the roof, or at least the ceiling. What are you doing? You're ruining everything. Here I worked so hard, and I've done all this, et cetera, you know. And he was just hollering at her. And suddenly, the child opened up his mouth and said, enough already, father. Die, Abba, die. It's die, which means stop in Hebrew. Enough. And Dvorah and Eliezer, you know, were wordless all of a sudden. He spoke.
Several years later, tragedy struck the Ben-Yehuda family. Dvorah contracted Eliezer's tuberculosis. And 2 years later, she died.
He felt a tremendous sense of guilt. And within 90 days of her death, 3 out of the 5 children died also. Not of tuberculosis, but of a flu epidemic.
Before she died, Devorah had written a letter to her younger sister, Hemda, who still lived in Russia.
She says, I'm going to be gone very soon, and it's going to be your turn. And then she put in another line, and she said, if you want to be a princess, come to Jerusalem and marry my Eliezer.
Hemda followed her sister's advice and wrote to Eliezer. He refused to marry her, fearing that he would give her the disease as well. But Hemda, like her sister, wouldn't take no for an answer.
And so she kind of forced his hand, and he married her. And she lived with him 30 years. And she had 6 children with him, 3 of whom died. The 2 children that survived from her sister, she raised. And she was my grandmother. His first wife was the love of his youth. He also adored and loved his second wife. But his second wife was not, you know, like a big romance love affair type of a thing. His second wife was his helpmate. If he would have continued the way he was with his first wife, he would have never finished the work. And probably the whole thing would have failed. God had prepared this woman for him. When Hemda Ben-Yehuda came and she saw his journals, she said, how do you know where the words are? How are you going to alphabetize the words? He says, well, what do you think in your great wisdom? And she said, index cards. You put each word on an index card. All the Aleph words are here, and all the Bet words are here, and all the Gimel words are here. And now you're ready to do a dictionary.
As his body of work grew, Ben-Yehuda was often targeted by Jerusalem's Orthodox Jews, who labeled him a heretic. They considered Hebrew to be a holy language and objected to using it for what they called idle chatter. He wasn't very popular with the new Zionist movement either. Their leader, Theodor Herzl, was from Vienna, and he envisioned a new Jewish state with German as the national language. When Herzl toured Palestine in 1898, he took just 5 minutes to meet with Ben-Yehuda. And that evening, he mentioned the encounter in his diary.
I met a young fanatic who tried to convince me that what our movement needs is to adopt Hebrew as our national language. It is, of course, ridiculous.
But Ben-Yehuda never strayed from his mission. He spent the next 2 decades working feverishly to finish his dictionary, sometimes 17 hours a day. The majority of Jews in Jerusalem were now speaking Hebrew. And in 1921, it became one of the 3 official languages of British-ruled Palestine, along with English and Arabic. By then, Ben-Yehuda's work had taken a fatal toll on his fragile health.
Eliezer Ben-Yehuda died in the month of December, in the second night of Hanukkah. My grandmother had a salon, you know, she was always entertaining friends, and Ben-Yehuda participated with them, and then he excused himself and he went back to his study, and he was working for a while, and then he lay down and he just couldn't wake up. When the people left, Hemda came into his room and she saw him lying there, and she started to talk to him and he didn't answer. He just returned his soul to God. A mere 40 years after he had been told that he has no future.
30,000 people followed his funeral procession from the old city of Jerusalem to the Mount of Olives, where he was buried. And today, one of the city's most popular streets bears his name, a tribute to the man who gave the Jewish people back their language. As one man put it, before Ben-Yehuda, Jews could speak Hebrew. After him, they did.
Imagine if there had not been an Eliezer Ben-Yehuda, and if in 1948 you would have had Jews living in Israel, speaking 70 to 80 languages, it would have never worked. The language was absolutely part of the rebirth. It was necessary as breathing is necessary to survival. And Ben-Yehuda is the man that God appointed to make that possible.